questions.
Thank you. No, this was the only question.
Okay, then we return to the Bhagavad Gita and to the purification of Hinduism, Buddhism. And I put them together. Many theosophists who study the Bhagavad Gita start with chapter 1 and read 2 and 3 and so on till chapter 18. But one of the earlier theosophists, Sabarro, who was an Indian pupil of the teachers of Blavatsky, and he was an Advaita Vedantist, he wrote a booklet, Notes on the Bhagavad Gita, and he was so right. What he explains is that Krishna takes Arjuna, the growing man, and Krishna, his higher self, his conscience, his intuition, his inspiration, you know it from earlier lectures, he and Krishna have a conversation during 18 chapters, and what Krishna does is from chapter 1 to chapter 6, going over the various lines of thinking in India at that time. And chapter 7 to 12, he gives his teachings about how the cosmos works and all those things. And chapter 13 to 18, he gives the information to the pupil, to the student, to the chela, how to spiritualize himself to reach moksha, nirvana, and then renounce it, to stay behind, to become a teacher. And Sabarro advised one thing. If you really want to understand Krishna, start your reading with chapter 13 and not with chapter 1. For chapter 1 is the overview of the armies, your own lower capacities and your own higher capacities. And Arjuna is loses courage to fight. And chapter 2 gives all the arguments to fight, seen from the Sankhya yoga direction of thinking in India, not Krishna. It starts with Sankhya yoga. Yes, you can see it. I cannot see what you see. Yeah. Yes, you see this line as well. You see chapter 2 Sankhya, 3 Karma, Jnana, Karma Sannyasa, and Atma Samyama yoga. All lines of thinking, of philosophy in India. And he goes from one to the other. And of all those lines of thinking, he shows the strong points and the weak points. And I want to show you that chapter 2, where everyone says, oh, that is beautiful, but Krishna advises me to kill. That is not true. Sankhya yoga advises to kill, not Krishna. Krishna advises totally other things in chapter 18. And I show it to you. And I hope, especially theosophists, take Sabarro as an example how to study the Bhagavad Gita really. And I read again with you, thou grievest for those that may not be lamented, whilst thy sentiments are those of the expounders of the letter of the law. Those who are wise in spiritual things grieve neither for the dead nor for the living. Nicely said, but if you are asked to kill, and you cannot cope with your conscience at the moment, then it is not enough just not to grieve because you're wise. You have to learn to see wisdom. And the next thing is, this spirit can never be destroyed in the mortal frame which it inhabited. Hence it is unworthy for thee to be troubled for all these mortals. In other words, the fact that we are a soul and we have a body, that doesn't make it right that you kill the body of someone because the soul is still there. You see, conscience conflict. Cast thine eyes towards the duties of thy particular tribe, and it will ill become thee to tremble. So be not afraid. A soldier of the Kshatriya tribe hath no duty superior than lawful war. And just to thy wish, the door of heaven is found open before thee. What is really said here is that if you do your duty, then you will reach heaven. And is it already a little bit known to you, this? If you do something, you can go to heaven. In other words, you will be rewarded. So whatever you do, you have a reward. The door of heaven is found open before thee. That is not the real compassion attitude. The compassion attitude is, I do things that are good for humanity as a whole, and I do not have to be rewarded by it. Later in this chapter, if you do not your duty, what are the reasons put down by the Sankhya Yoga line? Men will speak of thy ill fame. Oh God, people say something about me. You see how personal it is? The generals of the army will think that you acted from fear. So you are looking what other people say about you. And your enemies will depreciate your courage and abilities. So other people, generals and your enemies, speak negative about you. And that is the worst reason to do something. What will others say about me? This is not Krishna. This is the Sankhya teaching. And if you understand that, then we can go to chapter 18, where Krishna is teaching you. Let us see. 18. Yoga by renunciation of liberation. So you renounce nirvana. What are the duties of the Kshatriya in chapter 2? The Sankhya says you have to do your duty as Kshatriya, and they call it lawful war. And Krishna here says in 18, what are the duties of the Kshatriya born of his inherent character or svabhava are heroism, order, fortitude, resourcefulness, not fleeing from the battlefield. And then it comes liberality, and it is also translated as mildness and a princely nature. That means that your character is on a higher level. You see, nowhere killing, conquering, but not killing. And that is different from chapter 2. Do your duty as a Kshatriya, and what happens then? This is important. Having become one with Brahman, being of tranquil self, he grieves not, he yearns not. The same to all beings, he obtains my highest part. And that means that you are able to reach out not only to your inner teacher and your inner Buddha, but to that inner divine source within yourself, my highest part. I gave you in the other lectures 3 levels how to reach out to your inner possibilities. And here you obtain my highest part when you don't grieve, but be of a tranquil self. By this part of me, he knows me. How great and what I am fundamentally, you see, in essence. Knowing me fundamentally by this highest part of my nature, he forthwith enters into it. And that means that you become part of your inner God, of your inner Krishna, your inner Buddha. And then the chapter ends with compassion. When you enter into the inner Krishna of yourself, then you have a choice. And now the choice comes thus: the knowledge which is more secret than any secret has been communicated to you by me, that is teaching. And he who teaches this highest secret to my devotees will go to me free from doubt. In other words, Krishna, your inner Krishna, asks you to teach what you have learned in those 18 chapters, to teach those devotees to Krishna. And there is none among men who does dearer service to me than he. You see that when you become wise, that the result is doing service to all mankind. And this is Krishna. This is not having problems with your conscience anymore. For you, do your duties as a kshatriya with liberality and a princely nature. And you see that already in the world. For the whole Geneva Convention has been developed as a primitive effort to rule without killing. To make prisoners, perhaps, but not to kill. You see, if you concentrate as theosophist on chapter 18, you will never have the fact that later on people say, in the name of Krishna, we start to kill now. And the Buddha gives a dimension more. And I want to tell what the Buddha said. The Buddha had in his life, growing to enlightenment, the Buddha had also an enemy. And that was his nephew, Devadatta. And Devadatta did 3 efforts to annihilate the work of the Buddha. First of all, he split up the group of followers of the Buddha. And I can assure you, in theosophy, we have seen that many times. So that breach was repaired afterwards. And then Devadatta rolled a heavy rock in the direction of the Buddha. And halfway, the rock split into 2, and the 2 halves rolled along the Buddha, left and right. He was not hurt. And then Devadatta sent a raging, murderous elephant to the Buddha. And everyone fled, also his students, also his disciples, except Ananda. Ananda is a special disciple of the Buddha. And if you read text of sutras and the Buddha Karita, look at how Ananda behaves. And that is such an example for everyone who wants to go that same path. And the elephant kneels down at Buddha's feet. And then Devadatta, after many evil deeds, fell to the lower regions, cursed and despised by king and people, Brahmans and sages, but not by the Buddha. And in the Buddha Karita, that book, you cannot find why and how further the adventures of Devadatta were. But you can find that in the Saddharma Pundarika, in the Sutra of the Lotus of the Good Law. And there you find the last teaching of the Buddha. They call it on the vulture peak, the very last thing he did, very high, if you take it not literally, but occultly, you can say he taught on the highest level of consciousness to his disciples, to his arhats. And listen, what did he say? At that time, there was a rishi who said to me, "Great king, I have the Dharma teaching of the Supreme Sutra, the White Lotus of the Good Law. If you promise to be my servant, I will enable you to hear it." So there was a rishi who asked the king, "Be my servant, then I can give you all that wisdom." Bhikshus, that is disciples of me, yes? Devadatta was that rishi and I was that king many times ago. It was through relying upon Devadatta that I fulfilled the 6 perfections, paramitas, the 32 signs and 80 features of a great being, the 18 unique qualities of a Buddha, etc. Bhikshus, I declare to you, Devadatta will in a future time, after countless, innumerable eons or periods of time, be the Tathagata, the Arhat, the perfectly enlightened Buddha, Devaraja. And a Tathagata is one who follows in the footsteps of the Buddha before him. Yes, the line of Buddhas. You see, all cursed and despised Devadatta except the Buddha. Why? Because the Buddha could see over so many more incarnations. And when you do that, then you are wise enough to see what happened in those incarnations with that person, with the contact you had then. And this life, it is not so harmonious, but it will be harmonious in the future. And that is wisdom. And that is exactly what you can do at the present conflicts in the world, showing people that it is only in this incarnation that people stand against each other, but that in former and later incarnations, they have to be able to get along again. And that is where we have to work for the longer future, that people really understand that they are brothers. And we cannot prevent bombs falling now, but we can prepare the future by doing this very strongly and with a very wise heart. We can do that. And after this transition tale of the Bhagavad Gita from Sankhya, what will my neighbors say of me, to the real renunciation of Nirvana of chapter 18. And now you see this, the fifth class Buddha till the sixth class Buddha teachings, we can go to the voice of the silence. And that is really what I wanted to do with you. Do I have time? Yes? Let us do that. The voice of the silence, that booklet Blavatsky wrote, consists of teachings she received in Tashi Lumpo, in the environment of the Tashi Lama. So not the Dalai Lama, but the Tashi Lama, the guardian of the esoteric wisdom of Buddhism in Tibet. And a selection of lines she received, she wrote in that booklet. And it consists of three fragments. And the first fragment is in fact stages of Raja Yoga. And Raja Yoga is also in Buddhism, but it has its source in Hinduism. And in those lines of fragment one, there is a lot of killing advised, but never another being. Always parts of yourself. That is a quality better than what you read in the Old Testament and so on. But there is still killing. And I went over the booklet with a marker, and I help you to do that. So you must destroy thy lunar body. You must slay thy lunar form. You must crush out your personality. You must kill out desire. You must kill out love of life. You must strangle thy things. So this is quite something. Yes, I have it here. Where is it? You see, you have to destroy, crush out, and kill. And the Amsterdam people refused and revolted against this. And that poor Martin Leiderman has a trouble with Amsterdam during those 4 days of teachings he gave. But we helped him. And what I found in that same first fragment, you see verse 85, and in the fifth stage of Raja Yoga, O slayer of thy thoughts, all these senses again have to be killed beyond reanimation. And then you think, killing again, now I have to kill my senses. But there is a footnote, and now it is clear. Kill beyond reanimation is this means that in the sixth stage of development, which in the occult system is dharana, and that is concentration, every sense as an individual faculty has been killed or paralyzed on this plane, passing into emerging with the seventh sense, the most spiritual. Here, Helena Blavatsky gives a description of what killing is. Killing means paralyzing. And paralyzing means that your spiritual will, your will, is stronger than the will of your senses. And that means that you decide what to look at and what to hear, as an example. And nowadays, if you are honest with yourself, your eyes are working, not led by your thoughts. Your eyes just work, and you see everything, and start to be distracted. It's also with hearing. And the paralyzing means that You decide what to see, and you decide what to hear. And that is quite another way of living. That is dharana. That is concentration. It is paralyzing. It is becoming master of the will of your eyes. And this is what is really meant with destroying, crushing out, killing. It is all becoming master of. And if you have understood, then I go after your 3 minutes and some of your questions to the last extra part of this lecture. And if it is too much for you, you can see it tomorrow on you. Is it already tomorrow on YouTube?
Tonight,
I think so.
Tonight already.
So, lovely. Then we go to my favorite part of this precious booklet, the third part, where you really find the fifth and sixth class mentality of spiritualizing yourself. I think we keep it here. Ben, our 3 minutes are starting now. Yeah, Bouke.
We have a question. The Russian people at the moment who go on the street to demonstrate but not to fight, is that an example of the fifth class mentality?
I think it is. But what you see is that many revolutions the past century, not even so long ago, start with students doing exactly protesting against something, and they do it peacefully. And practically always those peaceful starting activities degenerate into violence. When you look the last 100 years, it always goes like that. In Yugoslavia, in many other countries as well. So you can demonstrate peacefully, but you must be so strong not to allow within your group any violence happening. We live here near the Peace Palace in The Hague, and I can assure you that we are surrounded by Ukrainian and Dutch and international people demonstrating in front of the Peace Palace. So they are our neighbors, the demonstrators. But the Russian embassy is at the end of our street. And someone put a bag with an explosive device before the door of that embassy. And at that moment, you can say someone is protesting, but using violence. It is so nearby, and that boundary is so easily overstepped. And you have to be a very strong character. You have to have a very good contact with your conscience to prevent that in a group of demonstrators. So it is fifth root race, but it degenerates very easily to the fourth class mentality. So it is yes and no, the answer. Are there more questions?
Yes, but maybe we can save them for after the last part.
Yes?
Yeah.
Okay. We do the last part of this lecture. It is a little bit longer than other parts because of the texts. Most of the time I do not use so many texts, but initiation tales is text. I give you the voice of the silence, the third fragment. And again, I do not give a study of that fragment three. It is only an overview of what you find with your marker when you mark all the actions you have to do with your lower self. First of all, the most important, thou must keep thy mind and thy perceptions for freer than before from killing action. And what you see, it is not, you shall not kill. It means it, that you have to not even kill in your mind. Not even think a thought of killing. And that is much more difficult than not killing anyone. But when you look at the news and you take sides and you say, good, another city and so on, then in your mind you are adding energy to the killing that happens at the moment. Thou must keep thy mind and thy perceptions far freer than before from killing action. And that means that you have to use your thinking faculties, your mind, to form you a crystal clear idea of what harmonizing and peace will be. And that must not be enough. It is a start. After that, you start doing things, writing letters, writing articles, contacting others to go the fifth class way to exercise that harmonizing and that peacemaking. Okay, thou hast to fight, thou hast to master, thou hast to learn to part thy body from thy mind and dissipate the shadow. Thy body is thy slave. You are the master. And you must, all mental changes in yourself and slay the army of thoughts, sensations, of passions, of whatever. You have to slay an army of instinctive thoughts within yourself. And if thou wouldst not be slain by them, then must thou harmless make thy own creation. You have to conquer them and make them harmless, but not killing, for thou must keep thy mind and thy perceptions far freer than before from killing action. You see what a initiation tale for now and for the future this is. This is what you can drink in and think it over. And if you do that well, you protect the theosophical spiritual impulse of the past century. You protect it from that generation to be used as an excuse in 1,000 years to kill others. I give you some more. You see, wave off the tempters in endless space. So when you are tempted to follow your fourth impulses, then wave them off in endless space. Have mastery over thy thought. Have mastery over thy soul. Conquer illusion. Be master of the sevenfold path. You see, and as a warrior, you have to attack the foe. Drive him from his stronghold. Vanquish him ere he himself expires. Act then, all you who fail and suffer, act like him as that fearless warrior. And from the stronghold of your soul, chase all your foes away. What are your foes? Not your neighbors, not Ukrainians, not Russians, but ambition, anger, hatred, even to the shadow of desire when even you have failed. You see, when we really strongly chase away ambition, anger, hatred, and desire from our character, at that moment, our attitude will be from a quality that around you no one even thinks to start a war. And that is why we have to conclude that the politicians at the moment are so weak that they don't inspire others not to use force. Yes, the military part of a country always sees that as a solution of a problem. The ambition, anger, hatred and desire overgrown politicians know how to handle that. And at the moment they are too weak to handle that. Okay, this is the difference between fragment 1 and fragment 3. You see that here is an initiation tale of the future. I have one thing more to give you. And there is not so much time anymore this evening. So I give you a little bit a hint. And next week we will have a study about this. And then I will go much more into the ideas of Godfried de Perruker, our fourth leader, who was active at the beginning, the way to the Second World War. And his wisdom, how to behave, how to prevent, how to guide that whole process of going to a war and how to ameliorate the situation, that is so wise, and I would like to talk that through with you, but we have to do it in a study. There is one thing I want to show you. In fragment 3, you have two rows, and I put it now on the screen, because then it is part of the lecture when it is on YouTube. What I found in fragment 3 is two lines of how you can behave. First of all, lower elements in yourself, attack them, fight with them, conquer them and vanquish them, make them harmless, have mastery over. You see that whole line, how you can do that. And there is another line that is drive out from his stronghold, chase away and wave off in endless space. And you see what happens. Then you put it out of your sphere of influence, out of yourself. Yes, you push it out of yourself, not to return to you again. So there is a part of you that you push out because it is not you anymore. And there is a part of you which you attack and in the end have mastery over. And that part is the part of which Godfried de Perruker speaks. What is he saying? He says, like the Devadatta for the Buddha, that influence that works against you, that attacks you, that tries to kill you, Godfried de Perruker uses the example of Judas with Jesus Christ in the initiation tale of the New Testament. And what he says is that any innocent has his enemy who works against it and tries to kill him. But as the Buddha did, never fight back. The Buddha never fought back against Devadatta, although all the kings around him wanted to do that. He knew how the influence of Devadatta could be harmonized. I show you. Where is it? Here. The personality, the lower self, betrays Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And in the occult symbology, silver is the moon and gold is the sun. And the influence of the moon is always the emotional, passional part of our being. And gold, the sun, is always the higher part of our being. And what is Godfried de Brugger saying in his book, The Dialogues? The personality must not be killed, but educated, ennobled, trained in selfishness. Judas is a Christ in embryo. And when you can see that in your lower instinct impulses, if you can see the same in your so-called enemies in your life, then you have made such a giant step on that path to enlightenment. And I want to end with the words of Godfried de Brugger: it is the duty of the Buddha or the Christ, of the Master, to save his own Judas, his own personality, and to turn him from being a bitterest foe, a most malignant and uncompromising opponent, into the greatest and most trusted helper. So if you have the illusion in your life that you have enemies, please try to find within yourself, within your conscience, a way to recognize that that enemy, bitterest enemy, a most malignant and uncompromising opponent, is in fact someone who will be, when you work hard for it, into the greatest and most trusted helper. I hope that I have given to you enough medicine to prevent in the future, in 1,000 years, the fact that people start killing each other in the name of Blavatsky and her teachers, in the name of theosophy, that you are one of the elements by which these precious wisdom will be unchanged and undegenerated. And this is even more important than whether you kill yourself or not by yourself, that you do not want to kill someone else. For we have a task to prevent that killing happening in 1,000 years, halfway the messianic cycle. The whole explanation of Godfried de Brugger, I hope to study together with you. We will put a text on the internet, so if you have not time to attend that study, study it for yourself, those wonderful texts and ideas where you can train yourself in being the fifth class solution of world problems. I hope this is enough, and I always forget how to end. We have still questions? Is that time for questions? Okay, we have questions.
We received a question that the sentence, you can neither slay or be slain, in the Gita, that it is difficult to understand without the knowledge of buddhi-manas and reincarnation and karma. Is that right?
Yes. And that expression in the Bhagavad Gita is in the second chapter. It is Sankhya wisdom. It is Sankhya teaching. The Sankhya teaching is duality. You have the background and you have the outer vehicle. And superficially, These are two different things, but that isn't true. It is one and the same when you look from a higher standpoint. And the idea that you cannot be slain and you cannot slay others, even when you kill someone's body, that is a wrong, how do you say that? A wrong way of thinking. For any living being, any soul who is reincarnated in this outer world is there because he is a part of humanity that is active at the moment. And humanity is not a family of nice living beings. Humanity, the human kingdom, is an organ, works as an organ of the living planet Earth, also a living being. So if you think I kill someone's vehicle, someone's body, and it can be, for there is always a soul, yes, then you rob the planet of an expression by which the planet can work. And the organ, human kingdom, is in fact the basis of the Buddhic capacities of our planet. You can say, when you think a wonderful ideal as a thought, and that is something that makes you better, then that thought is there to think. So the planet needs us, alive and well, active and well, to use for its development, for its evolution. This is perhaps a little bit difficult to understand, but think it over. And the moment you kill the body of someone else, then the planet has not all its capacity to express itself. So killing is always against nature. Even if the Sankhya says, oh, you can kill, for there is always the soul. Yes, and in chapter 18 you don't find that. Is that answer enough? I hope you understand the answer. If not, please come to the study or put your question again next lecture. We can always keep in contact. Are there more questions, Bauke?
This is it.
These are the questions for tonight. And we always end our lectures with the Gayatri from the Rig Veda. And why are we doing that? Because that text takes us as far innerly as possibly we can do. And I hope you use it in that way. O thou golden sun of most excellent splendor, illumine our hearts and fill our minds, so that we, recognizing our oneness with the divinity which is the heart of the universe, may see the pathway before our feet and tread it to those distant goals of perfection stimulated by thine own radiant light.